My name is Kevin Clark. I'm with Energy and Technology, and I'm here to welcome you, which I've done with open arms. And after that, I get a lot of questions that are basically the same day in and day out. So I put together 10 slides of just the most basic questions that I get to answer them. Once I do that, basically we have three presentations for you. We have our energy procurement director, and she's going to tell you what we have to do at SMECO and where we are when it comes to renewable energies. I also have our billing director, and our billing director is going to explain to you what happens if you do have a solar array on your roof and how we do credits and how we calculate, you know, forward and reverse ratings and things like that. The last person I always say is the most important person in the room, because he gets all the difficult questions, and that's why we save the best for last. And he is our engineer, and he is the one that basically inspects everything that comes across the desk that has to do with solar, and comes out and verifies information. And at the end of what he goes through, he and I will both be up here for questions. Typically, we have at least 30 minutes for questions, sometimes more than that. And like I say, if there's anything that you're not able to ask us here tonight, get our contact information. You can call us anytime. In the movie, it showed a mechanical meter. And if your solar array was generating and you didn't have a net meter on, it did spin that mechanical meter backwards. A digital meter will not do that. If you don't have a net meter and your solar array is generating power, it's going to go forward. So, in other words, it would cost you twice as much if you didn't have this switched out to a net meter. So we'll explain that process, but anytime you get a solar array, the applications we need are to let us know when it's time to come out and switch that meter. Now, another reason this meter is so important is because when Lynette gets to her part, she's going to talk about the way it's built. And when we put a net meter on, it's going to have a forward reading, a reverse reading, and it's going to show you KW consumption. What's important about that is you're going to be able to see your credit on your bill each month thanks to the readings of this net meter. Which leads me to say that I think a lot of you don't understand, but a solar panel and this meter are really somewhat incompatible. I don't know if anyone would know why or not. But the reason is the solar panel takes all the heat, does all the work, and this meter gets all the credit. So let's go to my questions. What is solar electricity? Photovoltaics, or PV, can literally be translated to light electricity. Photocells convert light into electricity. How long does this system last? 20 years, as long as it's maintained, installed properly, designed properly, and oftentimes even longer than that. Can I use PV to power my home? Of course, a PV system can be designed to power your entire home's electrical system if sized appropriately. However, most of the customers size the PV to simply reduce their energy consumption, so they don't expect it to power their entire home, although they can be sized to that. How do I know if I have enough sunlight for PV? A PV system needs unobstructed access to the sun's rays for most or all the day. Shading on the system can reduce energy output. The climate is not really a factor like you would think. As long as it gets the sun, it doesn't have to be in Miami or California. It could be in a colder climate such as Colorado and actually generate more energy in a cold climate with a clear sun view. How big a solar energy system do I need? What can you afford? I mean, it really does come down to that. You could buy a system, you could lease a system. If you all have looked into the cost, a lot of times it is cost prohibitive, especially as you get into larger sizes. So bottom line is it's going to depend on your budget and what you're looking for. Where can I find someone who designs, installs, and maintains photovoltaic systems? I said you could look for a PV installer in the telephone directory, and then I realized that not too many people have telephone directories anymore. But you could also go on your internet and Google search solar installers in Southern Maryland, and you'll see a list of them come up. How do I know if I've selected a reputable installer designer? Ask for any certifications that they have acquired. Ask for references and check with the Better Business Bureau and see if there's any customer complaint. The main thing I like there is ask them for references. Ask them if you could talk to some other customers and, you know, get some feedback from them. How much does a solar energy system cost, and how much will I save on utility bills? I spoke on it. You know, the answer is basically depending on the application, the size of the system. Things to consider are the incentives. Whoever your installer is, or if you're going to lease the system, they're going to kind of put together a prep spreadsheet for you. It's going to show you if there's any incentives available, what the applicable tax credits are, and the current cost of electricity as they put that proposal in front of you. Are solar panels right for my home? These are the things to consider. What is the size of your electric bill? The size, condition, and the material of your roof is important. You could roof mount them, which most of them do, but you can also ground mount them. The amount of direct sunlight your roof receives is going to directly affect what your solar array is generating. The availability, again, of solar rebates, tax credits, and incentives in your area, and like I emphasize, your budget. You could start off small and add to that if you're happy, or if budget's not an issue, sky's the limit. What should I look for if I'm going into an agreement to lease a solar system? Make sure that you have all the facts before signing a long-term contract, and if you're leasing, those contracts typically are long-term. How much energy is the system going to produce? How much is it going to reduce my energy consumption for? And who will be responsible for maintaining and the upkeep on the life of the lease? What should I look for if I'm going into an agreement to lease a solar system? A few things. First off, is my price set for the life of the lease, or is there an escalating rate? That escalating rate a leasing company will put in to protect their investment. But at the same time, a lot of times that escalator may be greater than the utility escalating rate. So you can always negotiate a contract. You know, I would say at least ask if you'd put in some type of addendum that basically says, yeah, if the utility rates escalate, I have no problem with you escalating your rate. But what if utility rates are stable for 5, 6, 7 years? What if they go down and the escalating rate is going up and all of a sudden I'm paying more for solar than I would be paying off the grid? So very important to understand that. On that same note, can I get a fixed rate for the life of the lease? Instead of that escalating rate, instead of paying maybe 6 cents per kilowatt hour, charge me 10 cents per kilowatt hour, but it'll be for the 20-year lease instead of 6 or 8 cents going up 3% every year for the life of the lease. Do I have an option to buy after a certain amount of time? Also know that even though you may lease a system that it is supplying your energy, you will continue to get a bill from the utility. A lot of people think, especially if it's large enough to generate electricity for their entire home, that they're cut off from the grid now. That's not the case. You can isolate yourself from the grid, but that takes battery systems and a lot more money and other issues that we could talk about later if needed. And those are the questions I get asked every day. I hope I answered some of them. If there's any more that you need to ask me, again, after Beth, Lynette, and Herb talk, we're going to open it up to everybody. So Beth Kennedy is going to talk about what we do here at SMECO.
Ten years ago, the Maryland legislature enacted the Renewable Portfolio Standard in Maryland. It's the RPS. And it requires that all suppliers of retail electricity provide a certain percentage of their sales from renewable energy or in the form of a renewable energy credit. There's two ways you can do that. You can buy the RECs in the market, or you can contract for renewable energy, have it attached to your grid, connected to your grid, or contract for renewable energy itself. There are several types of RECs, renewable energy credits. There's tier one, which is solar, wind, biomass, methane, geothermal, ocean waves. Poultry litter incineration is a big source of RECs on the eastern shore. There's a lot of chicken farms over there. They burn the chicken waste and they get RECs for that. Tier two is large hydro. Solar, although solar is a tier one REC, there's a carve out for it in the state of Maryland. So every year, a certain percentage of that tier one requirement has to come from solar. You can't buy it all from wind or geothermal or waves. And offshore wind, last year the legislature passed a bill that will enable offshore wind to be developed off the shore of Maryland, off the eastern shore. It's to become effective in 2017. The regulations are still being developed, and we're not 100% sure that it will actually come to fruition. But in the event that it does, we'll be required to buy RECs from that offshore wind project. It's hard to see, but it will give you an idea of what the RPS does, what it means. So 2014, this first year right here, 0.35% of SMECO's retail sales, what we sell to our customers, has to be provided in the form of solar energy or solar RECs. 9.95% has to come from other tier ones, such as the wind or the waves or the geothermal. And 2.5% has to come from tier two or the hydro. If we don't supply that percentage for every megawatt hour or every REC that isn't provided, we pay $400 for the solar, $40 for the wind or the geothermal, or $15 for the tier two, the hydro. That ramps up 2025, 2% of our sales has to come from solar, 15.5% has to come from tier one, and the tier two goes away in 2018. The alternative compliance penalty, that's the penalty that I was talking about on the other slide, the $400 for solar. If a utility has to make an alternative compliance penalty payment, they don't procure the RECs that they need, those payments go into the Maryland Strategic Energy Investment Fund, and that fund is used to provide grants or tax credits to help enable other projects to be built in the state. Typically, we buy from the market rather than paying the alternative compliance penalty because the market is cheaper. Right now, you saw the solar penalty is $400. In the market, a solar REC is about $150. Our total 2013 compliance cost, this is for the solar, the tier one, the tier two, was about $3.3 million. And we expect that our 2014 compliance costs will be about $8 million. So we have, instead of buying all of our RECs from the market, we've hedged a little bit. We have two wind contracts in Pennsylvania. Stony Creek is near Johnstown, Pennsylvania. We get about 62,000 RECs from that project each year. Mehoopany is near Scranton, Pennsylvania. And we get 99,000 RECs from that project annually. And I suspect most of you have probably seen our SMECO Solar project up here in Hughesville. It's a 5.5 megawatt solar project. We were able to take advantage of a 30% federal tax grant to offset those costs. Our cost of developing or borrowing was cheaper than a developer's cost, so that project, SMECO was able to build it and own it for much cheaper than we could have bought it from somebody else for. And this says we're currently working with UV Solar. We actually just contracted with UV Solar for a second project. It's 10 megawatts. We will not own this project. UV will own this project. We will buy the energy and the RECs from this project, and it will provide about 20,000 each year. And we do these contracts, the solar and the wind contracts, through an organization called the National Renewables Cooperative Organization. And they do this sort of thing for cooperatives across the country.
This is an example of how a regular bill looks. You see right here what your meter reading was this month. This is what it was last month. Subtract the difference, and this is what you get billed for. It's only tracking your forward energy usage, whereas a net meter that Kevin showed you earlier tracks both forward and reverse usage. If you do get a solar installation, this is what your bill is going to look like. You're going to have two columns on the bill. One's going to be your forward, one's going to be your reverse. Same situation, take this month's reading, subtract last month's, multiply it times the multiplier. This is what your energy usage is for your forward. This is what it is for the reverse. And what you do, you come down here and do the math, you take the 544 minus the 463, and what you get billed is 91 kilowatt hours. Now, in this case, this customer had a credit. His forward usage was less than his reverse. So he had a 22 kilowatt hour credit. That credit will be carried forward to next month to offset his bills. So for this month, he got was billed for 0 kilowatt hours, and he carried to next month 22 kilowatt hours. The only time this wouldn't happen if it were April. In April, we refund that credit at a monetary rate. Now here's another case. In this case, the customer actually had forward usage. We have the 828 forward and the 503 reverse with a net difference of 325. But he had a credit of 171 kilowatt hours from last month, and that reduced his bill down here to 325 kilowatt hours. See, right here was the 325, and then in the next slide, we took out the 171 and he got billed for 154 kilowatt hours. I talked about April as being the settlement month. It's required by Maryland law that we take a credit and provide it on the April bills. We didn't pick April, the legislature picked it for us. If you have a balance on your net excess generation credit as of April, we're going to refund it. And this is what your bill will look like in April if you have a credit. In this case, this customer had a 69 kilowatt hour credit. And down here, that totaled out to be $4.10. So we have the bill that you will receive every month. You'll receive a facilities charge and an electric universal service charge. And in this case, that was reduced right here by the credit, and his bill for April was $4.87. And what we do after that credit is refunded, we start back in May, that balance is reset to zero, and we start for the next year. So for the next 12 months, whatever credit you have either carries forward or is used up, and then it's refunded in April.
So my job here, again, if I do it correctly tonight, is to answer those questions and walk you guys through the whole process of how to get from a decision to install solar all the way to completing the process and making sure that you end up with a product that you're happy with. One of the best resources and the way I would recommend everyone in this room to get started if they want to go down the path of installing solar at their home or business is come to SMECO's webpage. Jennifer has our homepage up here, and the key thing to take note here is the webpage address up at the top corner where she has it highlighted there in red is SMECO.coop, C-O-O-P. When you get to the webpage over on the left-hand side where she has it highlighted there in green, you'll see a tab that says Your Energy. Click on that tab, and it'll bring you up to our next page. About halfway down where she has it highlighted there is called Net Metering. Click on that link, and that's where you're going to find all of our applications, descriptions of our processes, probably more information on solar than you may care to look at. But all these resources are one nice convenient place. If we scroll down about halfway, and Jennifer's going to stop right about there, the very first section of about five sections says printable applications, and that's where we're going to start. So while I'm talking, I'm going to ask Jennifer to click on the first link that says Level 1 Application and Contract. And this is an important point to make it decision. If you're going to install a solar system, the state of Maryland has done one thing nice for us here in that they've set the same type of rules for every utility across the state. So if you live in a Baltimore Gas and Electric Service territory, it's the same rules as if you go to Allegheny County, the same rules if you come down here to SMECO. We all have the same forms that we follow and all ask for the same information, and the whole net metering process is basically consistent throughout the state. So that's a very, very good feature. We have four levels of applications when it comes to solar net metering type applications. Everyone in this room is most likely going to fall into either what we call a level one application or a level two application. And the deciding factor as to which one of those levels applications you need to fill out is the size of your system. So 10 kW system stands for 10 kilowatts. And if you decide you're going to put solar panels onto your house or business and the size is 10 kilowatts, or less, you qualify for what's called an expedited application review under a level one scenario. It's a much simpler application and a much simpler, straightforward review process. If you decide to go a little bit more aggressive and do a system that is greater than 10 kW, that puts you into a level two category. It's a little bit more complicated, but not too bad. Just a little bit more in-depth application, ask a few more questions. There's a fee associated for someone like myself to go through and basically check out the larger system. And two key things that we're looking for is to make sure that system is safe and it's reliable. We want to make sure that whatever self-generation type system you put on your house doesn't cause you any kind of power quality problems for yourself, but maybe even more importantly, doesn't affect your neighbor and cause any power quality problems for your neighbor. The cost for a level two application review is $50. Plus $1 per kW. So if you put in a 20 kW system, it's going to be $50 plus $1 for the extra 20 kW, so you'd have a review fee of $70. Okay? What we're looking for here in the application, a couple different categories. The first thing is we need to make the utilities all aware of what your intentions are so we can, again, ensure that what you're doing is safe and reliable for everyone. We're going to ask for your name, going to ask for the address. In this case, what's your SMECO account number? Who's your installer? And I'll pause right here where it says equipment contractor installer, because one of the questions I get all the time is, hey, I know a little bit about electricity. I want to do this myself. Can I do it? And the answer is, yeah, you can. But the caveat I like to put to that is you really need to make sure that, one, you're mechanically inclined, have a good solid electrical background, that you understand some electrical theory, that you've done your homework, and you have a good, I'll say, practical working knowledge of the local county codes and what's required to actually put these systems together. If you have those traits, you may be able to do it. One additional trait that a lot of folks may not have, and I see this a lot with electricians. Electricians are very good. They know how to wire panels correctly. They know how to connect things together in a safe and reliable fashion. But a solar system, if it's not properly the components selected so that the individual panels, as they're chained together, made up and match up properly, and they produce the type of input voltage that your inverter wants to see, and the individual strings or arrays that we'll talk about later on are all matched together, so all the components are matched together and that the panels are aimed at the optimum angle of the sun and all that kind of stuff, you may spend a lot of money and find out that your system isn't working as optimally or providing the type of efficiency in generating power that you started out and thought you were going to get. So again, you can do it as a homeowner, you can do it as a licensed electrician. Just make sure that you understand the design process and you design yourself a good system from the ground up. That being said, there's a spot up here where you can have the equipment contractor, the manufacturer of the panels and so forth, any other alternate contact information that you feel may be necessary. And typically what we're looking for here, if it's available, is an email address. And what will happen is you decide you want to do this here. Most folks will have, like I said, a solar installer that'll walk you through this process. And 9 times out of 10, they're the ones that are going to fill these out for you. Okay, they're going to help you. You'll give them an account number, and they're going to fill out these forms for you. What will happen is you'll submit it to SMECO. And at the very bottom of our webpage that we'll look at here in just a few minutes, it'll give you all the contact information, all the addresses, the phone numbers that you need. Most of the applications come to SMECO through email. There's also a link on the webpage that if you want to click on that link and submit it right through the webpage, you can do that. If you prefer to walk it right up to our counter, you can come to the cashier, drop it off here. If you prefer snail mail and want to put it in the mail and wait for the postman to deliver it, you can do that. You can fax it in. We take it just about any way we can get the application. What happens from that point is our administration services group will get that application, and they want to make sure that we have a complete application, that we have everything that the engineering department needs to review it in its entirety. So they're looking for the application. One thing they want to make sure is that whoever is the SMECO utility account holder, that name on the electric bill matches up with the name that's on the application. A lot of times we'll get the husband may have the electric bill in his name, but the wife ends up submitting the solar application. And when you put the two together, it causes confusion, not only here, but up at the state level. Later on, if you go to apply to the state for what we call renewable energy credits that we'll also talk about, the state doesn't like to see different names. They want to see everything consistent fashion. So we want to make sure we have that correct and that it's signed by the correct party. The second thing we want to know is tell us a little bit about how you're planning to put these components together. So we'll ask for what's called an electrical one-line diagram. And basically what that shows us is how you have your DC panels configured, how you have them proposed to wire together into what we call a combiner box, how you propose that to connect down into your inverter, and where in your house are you going to plug this into? Are you going to use a double pole circuit breaker in a main panel box? Are you going to try to install a new separate panel box? Or how are you going to interconnect that into your existing house service or building service so it backfeeds through our meter? We'll also look for a simplified, what we'll call a site plan. We want to know where your electric panels sit in relation to your disconnect switches, in relation to your meter, in relation to your inverter, so we can make sure that all your components are accessible to utility personnel if they should need them, and to make sure that they're oriented in a fashion that makes sense. We'll ask for what we call an annual energy estimate. Most folks will refer to, it's a freeware on the internet, it's called PV Watts, PV Watts. It's a pretty simplistic input program, and basically it'll say, how many panels are you putting in, what's the wattage of the panels, what's their orientation with respect to the sun, what's their azimuth, what's the efficiency of your inverter, where are you located, are you in Baltimore, are you in Virginia, where are you located? And basically what that'll do is it'll take all that information and it knows how many daylight sun hours are available where you live, and it'll know what angle the sun is with respect to the azimuth and orientation that you put on your application. It's going to give you an estimated annual energy output for that system. And what we're going to do with that is we're going to look and say, okay, if your system generates 10,000 kilowatt hours a year, but your electric bill is only 5,000 kilowatt hours, we want to make sure that the homeowner or the business owner realizes that they're installing much more solar capacity than what they can physically use in a year. That's a personal choice. The state law says that you're allowed to oversize your system for up to 200% of your previous 12-month history. And the reason when the net metering laws first came about a couple years ago, they set that value at 120%. And they said, we want to make sure the original intent of net metering is to allow a homeowner or a business owner to offset part or all of their existing electric bill. The idea wasn't to oversize the systems to try to make money and sell it back into the grid. That wasn't the original intent of net metering. Well, when they set it at 120%, we started getting some questions and concerns that, hey, my 12-month average bill, it was a very cool summer last year, or it was a more mild winter, so my 12-month history is less than what I know it's going to be next year. I want to size my system bigger. Or we realized that, hey, this is a computer estimation program. There's some error built into that, so I'd like a little bit more leeway to make sure that I'm putting in the correct amount of solar. So they raised those limits to 200%. It also works out good that we get some folks that say, hey, you know, I was overseas, I'm in the military, so I was only home for 6 months out of the year, but now I come back to the States and I'm moved back into my house, so my energy use is going to go up, and you're not letting me have the full value of what my electric bill is going to be in an upcoming year. So they increased it to 200% to kind of give those leadways to help out both the utility and the homeowners to size their system correctly. Okay. Once we get all that information, what's going to happen then at SMECO, the Administration Services Department, is going to send an email, what we call, hey, we received your application, everything seems to be here, it seems like we have all the information we need, and we're going to send it through to our engineering review team to take a look at it. So they'll acknowledge within 5 business days that you have a completed application here at SMECO. From that point, depending on workload and how many applications we get, engineering may be able to review your application as soon as 1 day, but it may take up to 3 weeks to review it. At that time, we're going to look at all those things. Again, the key components is to make sure it's safe and it's reliable for our utility, and to make sure there's no utility upgrades. Maybe you're installing a larger system at your house than what is really needed to operate the loads at your house, and it says, hey, this distribution transformer out in the pole needs to be upgraded, or some other enhancement needs to be made at the utility infrastructure to support this project. And that's what we're going to be looking for. After that review, what will happen is the Administration Services Group, again, to all the emails that are provided on this application, will send back what's called a conditional approval. And that basically gives you the green light to go ahead and purchase your materials. You can buy your panels, buy your inverter. You can actually sign the contract with your installer and give him the green light to go ahead and pull the permits for the county electrical and sometimes building permits that are needed, and go ahead and do your installation. So your contractor goes out, he does the whole installation for you, he commissions it and says, okay, homeowner, business owner, I've done my work, everything is complete and satisfactory, is now operational, and you concur that the work is done correctly, and we're ready to turn it over to SMECO. What SMECO is going to ask for at that time is, one, proof that you have the local county out to do an electrical inspection for you. And what we like to see is those little green stickers that they like to place on your distribution service panel or on your disconnect switch or something that says, hey, approved, with a big check mark. You don't want to see the red sticker. That means something went wrong. So a lot of people, they'll take a photo of that sticker and they'll email that photo to us showing that it's been approved. We're going to ask you to complete this form. And basically what it's going to do is say, hey, here's my installer, here's my address, here's my account number, and as far as we're concerned, all of our work is complete and ready for SMECO to come out and take a look at it. When we get those two pieces of information, either myself will come out and take a look at it, depending on the complexity of the system, or we may just dispatch it directly to the meter shop, and they'll go out with a net meter here, and they'll look for something like your disconnect switch and just make sure that the inverter that you said you were going to install matches up with the paperwork and make sure that everything looks correct, and they'll swap out your meter. And that time we'll sign off on your certificate of completion and we'll say, congratulations, you're now the proud owner of a solar system. Enjoy. And the process is done. Okay. If you go back to the homepage for me, Jennifer, if you were a level two application, you can click on the level two application here. And if you go with a level two application, instead of a quick and easy one page, what we call terms and conditions or legalese that you would sign off and agree to, it goes from one or two pages to maybe 22 pages. So just a little bit more of legalese that you're welcome to read if you have insomnia at night, I guess. If you go down to the next section here, Jennifer goes to, this is what we call our interconnection standards. And this is a good source that if you have a lot of questions as to exactly how this stuff fits together, two of them that I'm going to pull up here today. The first one up here is number two on our list under solar. And I like this one here because it basically depicts a very simple solar system of what it might look like and how the components might fit together. So the way this works, in this installation we have these rectangles up here are the individual solar panels that you might choose to put on your roof. And Kevin indicated earlier you have several choices. You can mount them on your roof, which we see quite often. Or if you happen to have a large parcel of land that's cleared and has a good view of the sun and so forth, you may decide to do a ground mount system and actually mount those panels off to the side of the house. It's really your choice as to your preference. But what happens here is each one of these individual panels has a rating with them. I like to compare it to putting batteries into your flashlight. When you put batteries into your flashlight, each one of those little D-cell batteries is a certain voltage level. And the more batteries you put in, the greater voltage you get, and that's what makes your flashlight, when you turn it on, shine nice and bright. The same kind of thing happens with these panels. Each one of these panels might have an individual, might have a voltage rating of anywhere from 30 volts to 50 volts. And what happens is these inverters that we're going to talk about here in a second are specific, and they want to see an optimized input DC voltage. So what we do is we take each one of those individual solar panels and we daisy chain them together in a series so that if each individual panel was 30 volts and we put 10 panels together, we would say 30 volts times 10 panels, we have an input voltage of 300 volts DC. They may range anywhere from a 300 volt DC to maybe as much as 600 volt DC, depending on the type of inverter you pick down here, what it's optimized for and what it wants to see as an input voltage. Okay, so you'll daisy chain them together and you get those panels together to get your optimum DC input voltage. Once you get that, what we're going to do is we'll call each one of these a string. So as you daisy chain these together, that forms a string. And what we're going to do now is we want to work to get our capacity up. We want to get enough capacity so we can actually power the loads that are inside your house and provide the power and energy savings that you're looking for here. We'll take these individual strings and we'll just start adding additional strings, maybe one up here and two more down here, in parallel with one another. So as you put them in parallel with one another, you increase the capacity of your system. They all get combined together in something fancy called a combiner box or multiple combiner boxes. It takes all those DC circuits and combines them together. And they typically come down to what we'll call a DC disconnect switch. A lot of times that switch is integral to the inverter, and basically it just gives you a place if you need to disconnect the DC power to work on the inverter, gives you a switch to basically open up that circuit so you can work on it. The inverter right down here, which is a core piece of the system, its job is to take that DC power and convert it into AC power, which is what you have on your wall outlets that you see here. So it takes the DC power at 300 to 600 volts DC, and typically it's going to convert it to 120/240 volts, which is what you have for an electric service at your house. From there, we want to come over into this thing that's called a solar AC disconnect. And what this is this gives the utility personnel a place. If we have to come out in the middle of the night and say there's something going on and we need to work at your meter base or do some work out at the distribution transformer or something out on the street in front of your house, OSHA rules and regulations say that all utility personnel or all personnel, even if you're not utility personnel, that wants to safely work on a piece of equipment needs to make sure that you have the ability to visually open up the circuit and lock out that circuit in an open position to make sure any stored mechanical or electrical energy cannot backfeed in and give you a shock. So in the case that something would happen that we need to go out there and work and we wanted to do a follow safe work practices and abide by OSHA rules and regulations. That just gives our utility linemen a place to open up the switch, put their little padlock on it, and feel safe that nothing's going to backfeed from your solar system to give them a shock. The other thing, I'll backtrack just a second, is we'll talk about the solar inverter, and underneath here you see in letters it says UL 1741. Every single piece of electrical equipment you buy, from a television set to a cord, you usually see those little stickers on them somewhere that nobody reads, and it has that nice little UL label on it. And what that label says is it's been tested according to a given test standard to make sure that device or that component meet certain safety standards. We want to see for a grid-tied inverter, which is what this is, it's you're looking to tie your self-generation source, your solar panels, into the utility grid. We want to see that it has a label listing of UL 1741, and what that does is it tells us that that packaged unit has been tested to make sure that it's safe and reliable according to a predetermined set of standards, so that if there was a fault somewhere out on the utility system, say a tree limb came down on a power head line and caused an outage. Well, what we don't want to happen is we don't want your solar system to continue to generate power, because what will happen, you think about it, up on the top of that pole you have this nice little gray cylindrical thing we call a transformer. The purpose of that transformer is to take the utility voltage at 7,200 volts and transform it to something you can use in your house, 120/240 volts. That transformer is bidirectional, it works both ways. So if there was a fault out on the utility line and we lost power but your solar system didn't turn off, your solar system would produce 240 volts on one side of the transformer, and lo and behold, when you get to the other side of the transformer, you have 7,200 volts and a shock hazard for the guys out on working on the lines. So what this UL inverter says is if you lose the utility input waveform or signal, there's a contact switch built into those inverters that will open up immediately and basically isolate your solar system. So you'll still have a DC input voltage. That will not change, but the inverter will not allow any AC voltage to be generated on the output side until the utility voltage comes back. Okay. From there, we talked about the solar AC disconnect switch. Typically, we'll go into our building main distribution panel. That's your breaker panel box that might be located in the garage or in a bedroom or down in the basement. And depending on the size of your system, you may just be able to add a separate branch circuit breaker into that box. So you may have to tap into the line that goes between the meter, what we call the service entrance, between the meter and the panel. Your installer will decide, depending on the size of your system, how they need to interconnect that into your system. But that's in a quick and dirty, simplistic sense, that's how the components basically fit together to produce the power and let you enjoy the solar power in your house and also safely interconnect it back to the utility. Jennifer, if you would go back to the home page one more time for us. The other one I'll just point out here down here is number 12. This is a real good pamphlet. It's a couple years old. It was put out by NRECA. It's a national organization, and basically it's a homeowner's guide to solar electricity. Serves kind of the same purpose of what we're trying to do here tonight, and that's answer questions and educate the customer as to how these systems work and what kind of questions, if you're going to hire a reputable contractor to do your design and to do your installation, what kind of questions should you ask them? What's the cost of this system likely to cost me? You know, a little bit about how does solar work and so forth. It's a real good summary. It's maybe like, I think it was 6 to 8 pages. Does that sound right? 6 to 8 pages long. It's very, very easy read, and it's a good source to kind of get you started as well. A little bit further down from here, we have a section called Links of Interest. This is good if you wanted to look to the Maryland Public Service Commission to see if the utilities are following the rules that they're supposed to, or see if there's any incentives or anything out there, or get a little bit more information on solar panels and solar electricity, you can go there. Maryland Energy Administration, same deal. If you're looking for more information, it's just another link, another resource for you. And down at the very bottom here, Jennifer, if you would, scroll down a little bit further, is all the contact information. So again, if you had a submittal, you wanted to submit an application, you come right here to Interconnections Admin, and any kind of paperwork submittals you might need to make, you would just email it to that address, and somebody at SMECO will take that information and process it. If you had a technical inquiry, you can use the one up above that says Interconnections Engineering. And we like to reserve those. I mean, if it's a specific technical issue that you're having and you need some advice on, that's where we'll send that. If it's any kind of a general inquiry or, hey, just looking for more information kind of thing, we would encourage you to look at the links that are already on the web page, or maybe go to the admin one to see if we can't find the best person to answer those questions for you. Then a little bit further down here is basically the phone number where you can reach us, mailing addresses, physical locations if you wanted to come into SMECO to drop an application off or so forth. Gives you all those links and all those resources.
What happens if lightning strikes my system?
Assuming that it's your property and
right.
you bought it,
right.
whoever your installer is, usually you're going to sign some type of maintenance agreement, service contract, manufacturer's warranty that'll cover those things. If not, you could always look at your insurance policy and run it by them and insure that as well, but you could absolutely cover it.
Can I install solar panels on my boathouse?
Wherever you choose to put them. The key thing, though, is any solar installation, we allow one solar installation per account, per electric meter. Okay, so if you have an electric service at your house and you have a separate electric service at your boathouse, and you put the panels on your boathouse and it ties into the boathouse meter, the only credits are going to go to the boathouse, not to your house.
Where will my credits come from if I have multiple units tying into one system?
Whatever electric meter you tie into, that's where the credits are going to go to. Now, if you put them on your boathouse, but you kept it isolated from the electric service at your boathouse, and you trenched over to your main house and tied in over there, that's where you're making your interconnection point at. So the answer is that house, that service over there will get the credits. So a key thing is wherever meter you tie into, that's where the credits go.
Can SMECO use smart meter technology to tie multiple units together?
Again, what you can do, the state says that if you're a nonprofit group, if you're a municipality, or if your services are for agricultural use, and that's the key thing that you're looking for here, you can do what's called virtual meter aggregation. Now, the key thing, again, is to look at your actual parcel of land and look at your county tax records to make sure that each of those, say you had five accounts, five barns and a house or something, make sure each one of those individual accounts were zoned for agricultural, and the primary use of each of those was agricultural. And if all five of those accounts had the same name, there's a form right at the top of this thing, says net meter aggregation form. Basically, you would say, who's my host account? Who's going to be the source for the panels and where they're going to interconnect to? And they get the credits up front.
Right.
If there's any remaining credits, who do I want them to go to in order? Two, three, four, five. And we will do just what you asked. So that is available.
Is the unit compatible with a backup generator?
That.
It can be compatible. The key thing here comes down to making sure your system is designed properly. And what has to happen is you have to have some kind of a transfer switch between your generator and your solar system. Because say there's an outage and the utility goes away and your generator kicked on. The solar system over here, it's smart, but it may not be able to differentiate between your generator as the source power and the utility as the source power. And it may try to energize and start producing power also, which can cause some issues. So what you have to make sure is that you have your solar system isolated from the grid, isolated from your generator through the use of a transfer switch or some other type of means. So it can be done, we do see it, and you just have to make sure that it's designed properly and reviewed and installed properly.
How much tolerance do the panels have?
If a fluorescent light is shining on a panel, if a street light is shining on the panel, if the moon's bright enough shining on a panel, or if the sun is shining on a panel, it's going to produce some voltage and therefore produce some power output. So optimally, if this is your panel, you want the sun to hit it at 90 degrees, that's its optimal angle. You're going to set, depending on where you are, latitude and longitude and so forth, you're going to adjust that azimuth and that angle of the panels to optimize the amount of time that it's seeing that perpendicular direction of the sun. But understand, the sun rises over here and comes across the sky. That angle is constantly changing. So at any given day, any given hour of the day, there's only going to be certain times where your system is getting that optimal angle. So it will drop off. If it's a 300-watt panel, you may at certain times get 300 watts out of it. Other times, you might only get 100 watts. If the clouds come over and all of a sudden you get a storm, you may get 10 watts. So it all depends on the conditions.
Will the solar panels act as a generator if there's a power outage?
No, it does not. It does not. In that gentleman's instance, if he had a generator and transfer switch, then he would go to generation when he lost power.
Okay.
If you had battery backup, or your batteries would go to backup and you could run your house. But if you lose power from the grid, you don't have battery or generator backup, unfortunately, you'll be out.
All right.
How robust are these systems to hail damage?
Each solar panel has a particular rating for hail. I will tell you, when we had SMECO, when we had this farm out here built, we had a specialist and engineer from Arizona who does a lot of solar farms. Mm-hmm. He said he's never seen a panel damaged by hail.
How many varieties of solar panels are available?
As far as the different solar types, there's probably only a handful.
Right.
But as far as the brands, there's hundreds.
Really, the market's at large.
Yeah, when you go to a catalog, you're going to look at, you know, different inverters, different controllers, different solar panels. Some are made in the U.S., some are made in China, some are made in Mexico. So,
is the load on the roof by the panels a part of the certification?
You want to get a reputable contractor, and they're going to look at all that stuff. You're right. Each panel weighs a good bit of weight. And when you put them all together,
150 pounds right
now. And you put that by 20 or 30 panels, that adds up. So certainly part of your permitting process, when you file to the county for a permit, usually they're going to ask for both electrical and they're going to ask for a structural or a building.
Okay.
And what will happen is that they're going to submit the weights and the loads and how they're going to fasten it down to your house, and it's going to get reviewed by the county. We're looking at it strictly for electrical reliability and safety. We want to make sure that what you install is safe.
Is each county different with their review process?
Each county is a little bit different, and they will typically ask you for a building permit and for an electrical permit. And part of that requirement is just like if you put a large shed or something, they want to see the contiguous fastening system of how your panels are going to fasten to the house, how they're going to fasten to the trusses, and make sure that they have it all fastened properly so you don't get a big wind gust and whoosh, your panels go sailing through the sky. They want to make sure you don't put all that weight up on your roof, and lo and behold, they collapse your roof. That's part of the county review process.
Does SMECO submit your application to the county?
The
first step, again, is when you fill out that application and submit it to SMECO, you haven't gone to the county or anybody yet, and what SMECO wants to do is make sure that you can safely tie into the electrical grid,
okay.
Because if you can't do that, then there's no sense in pursuing it any further. And then,
is there an advantage of buying rather than leasing the system?
Incentive. So if you buy the system yourself and install it yourself, you own it, I believe up until December of 2016, there's still a 30% federal tax credit, which means that come April when you file your taxes, 30% of your system costs may be eligible to be refunded on your taxes. That's something you can take into consideration. Again, this is money out of your pocket. So either you have that financing already in place, you have funds and you don't know what to do with it, so you're going to put it in solar, or maybe you need to take a loan out to do it, so you need to consider the cost of financing that project. Those are all questions to ask. If you lease, I like to compare it to an automobile. You know, if you lease an automobile, it really depends. You either put no money down or you put more money down. Depending on what you put down may affect, you know, how much money you pay each month for the next, you know, 20 or 30 years. The difference there is you don't own the system, someone else owns the system. They probably get the tax credits, not you. Another thing to keep in mind is if you sign a long-term lease, you know, 20 years or 30 years, and something happens, you decide 5 years down the road you want to move and sell your house, you still have that lease. You're still buying for that lease unless there's any kind of an assumption clause that you can transfer it to the new owner and the new owner wants to take it over. So, again, there's a lot of things, and it really is a personal decision.
If I install an addition on my house, will I need to install more solar panels?
It doesn't matter what you add to your house. When you have a system already designed, it's going to be one capacity. Now, you can add more panels. It may cause you to get a different inverter. As you add more capacity, you may have to get an inverter that's going to be able to control more capacity. But you can continuously upgrade a solar system.
How often do I need to clean my solar panels?
For the most part, the rain is going to clean them off for you. Now I have, like in the case of the solar farm up here, I believe it's once a year we actually have someone come out and actually cleans them. But by and large, if they're up on your roof, you're going to rely on the rain to keep them clean for you. Over time, naturally, just like a fluorescent light bulb, over time, the capacity of those panels will degrade. So if you look at your panels, there'll be a nice curve on it usually, and they'll guarantee that after 10 years, 20 years, whatever, it won't degrade more than, you know, 5% or 10%. But over time, the panels themselves, just by their very nature, will degrade a little bit, despite even having a cleaner dirt on the film.
Can you combine solar and wind power systems?
You can put in parallel inverter. You can put in two inverters at a house or three inverters at a house. You can put in an inverter and an inverter for a wind turbine.
Thank you.
As long as they're set up properly and isolated electrically where they need to be, and the overall capacity of those combined systems again matches your load on your house, there's no reason you can't do that. I think I have of all the ones I've seen, I think I've only seen one, maybe two, that actually have solar and wind at their house.
Is there high demand for solar panels in Charles County?
Maybe 5 years ago is when we really saw the first net metering application come in, and they were very few, you know, a handful of them. It's picked up in recent months, and I think a lot of that just has to do with people hearing about them more often and seeing ads, again, newspapers, flyers, and whatnot. I think the public's just becoming more aware of it. So we are seeing an uptick here in applications over the past couple months. I like to say it's kind of lumpy. I mean, you might go a few days, a few weeks, a few months with kind of low, and then depending on incentives and so forth, we'll see a spike in them. They may level off for a little bit. They may go back down. Right now, we're in a high peak.
How do the solar farms in Charles County affect my electric bills?
The cost that we're paying for the energy from either one of the solar farms is less than we would be paying to buy the solar RECs in the market and the energy. So it actually saves you money.
Is there a transfer switch that will disconnect your system from feeding back into SMECO?
That inverter, it has that contactor in there, so when it loses the utility signal, it opens up and it doesn't do anything else. Now, if you wanted to have that luxury, basically what you're talking about is a battery type system. So you would have a very smart inverter controller box, and what it would do is it'd say, over on this side I have input available from my solar system. Over on this side I have the grid, it's either there or it isn't there. Down here I have this battery bank, and up here I have the load of my house. And basically what it'll do is it'll determine which of those paths it allows to make contact or break contact. So if the utility goes away, it's going to sense that the utility disappeared. If solar is available and solar can offset the entire load of the house, that's what's going to happen. If solar is not enough to offset all of the load of the house, it's going to go down to the batteries. It's going to start taking power from the batteries. If the batteries start to get depleted a little bit, and the solar is enough to take care of all of the house, it's going to use some of that solar power, and it's going to go down to recharge the batteries again. So you have a very sophisticated controller box that would take care of all those functions for you.
How do the credits work with a solar panel system?
When you get your credits each bill, if you're generating more than what you're actually using and you see a credit, it's actually one for one. You're getting exactly what you're paying, we're paying you back. The difference is if you continuously get credits and all of a sudden April you have 100 credits built up, then you're not going to get a one for one. What you're going to get is what we pay for generation, and that's about 6 cents per kilowatt hour. Whereas when we're giving you a credit one for one, you're getting like 14.5 cents per kilowatt hour. So that's why you want to size your system properly, because you want that one for one. You really don't want to oversize where you get some money back, but it's not as much as what you're paying.
Does SMECO offer classes for homeowners interested in installing solar power?
There's no, SMECO does not offer that at the present time. But if you think about it, it really comes back to licensing requirements. That part of this process is you have to go to the county and you have to apply for an electrical permit and a building permit. If you don't have that electrical license, the odds are they're not going to let you get a building permit or electrical permit because you're not qualified, you haven't gone through the schooling and the training and have the practical proven knowledge to do that installation. Whether or not the county themselves will allow you to take a test, like if you want to wire your own house, you can go to the county and take a test through the county, and if you pass the test, they will grant you special permission just to wire your house, but they put certain provisions on it that limit the you can't wire your house and move out of it. You have to stay there X number of years, and they put certain requirements on it. That would probably be your number one Achilles heel with it. As far as if you wanted to learn more about it, if you went to any given manufacturer of inverters or solar panels or something like that, they also have classes where they can teach you that. Part of that same problem may apply, that they may only allow you or accept you into that class if you have a business and electrical license to begin with, as opposed to teaching just the homeowner. So I understand where you're coming from. It is a tough issue, but it really comes down to the licensing issues that they want to make sure systems are done properly.
Currently, are there any tax credits available?
Desire If you go to that link, it's going to be a map of the United States, and you click on Maryland, and it's going to show you every grant, every incentive, every energy efficient program in Maryland, statewide and countywide. And they change constantly, so you could go on there tomorrow and you may see Calvert County may have an incentive, but St. Mary's doesn't, but that's the place to look. We thank you very, very much for not only attending, but for your questions.